Number Quint. You're watching IPO Adda, and my guest today is from Sapphire Foods India, which is a franchisee for Yum Limited. They run a chain of restaurants, which is KFC, Pizza Hut, and Taco Bell in India, Sri Lanka, and Mauritius. Maldives, and they are coming out with their offer for sale, which is of nearly 2,073 crores at a price band of 1120 to 1180 per share. I have joining me Sanjay Purohit, who is the whole-time director and group CEO, and Vijay Jain, who is the chief financial officer of the company. Gentlemen, good morning and welcome to Bloomberg Quint. Let me start with the valuation part of it. I was just going to the RHP and I saw that there was a placement which was made by you guys in August to investors, which includes Sapphire as well as Edelweiss at 505 and 544 rupees odd. And now within a few time, you're pricing your offer for sale at nearly double the price at 1120 to 1180. How do you justify this jump in valuation?
So, Vijay, do you want me to take
it? So, Sajid, important to understand the reason behind the private placement round, which happened just a few months back. It was more of a strategic in nature. All our investors are private equity investors who have been there for more than 6 to 7 years, and they wanted a partial exit, as well as we wanted to go for an IPO and solve for two areas. One, promoter requirement from SEBI point of view, that who will be the promoter. And also from a Yum point of view, we required a lock-in who would be a long-time play partner to Yum and be there for a perpetual lock-in kind of a scenario. So the private placement round enabled this. The new investors who came in, they along with Samara Capital, who is the existing investors from day one, they have locked in 25.1% of the share capital almost on an indefinite basis. So it was a strategic round, and that's the reason the valuation where it was. Now, the current valuation, which is which we're talking about the price band 1120 to 1180, the strengths of Sapphire, which will the two global brands which we operate in a short period of time, the scale which we have built, 482 stores as of 30th of September, the EBITDA 18.9% last year pre-ESOP, which is top three in the industry, our execution, which we have demonstrated over the last 5 years, our omnichannel format, and our future plans in terms of organic as well as inorganic growth, those have gone as inputs to the current price band. And the market itself, the macro fundamentals on QSR industry, it's very nascent. We believe it's a multi-decade opportunity. The industry is supposed to grow double in next 5 years with a 15% CAGR. And within that, the QSR will probably have a giant share, 54% mix in this particular industry. This combined with our advice from our bankers, this is their conversations with various investors which they have met, along with the conversation with shareholders, has enabled them to arrive at the right price for the bank, which is
I get the regulatory requirement part, Vijay. My question is that just because it's a regulatory requirement, you have place your primary shares to Sapphire and Edelweiss at half the prior fair value. Is that what you're saying? Secondly, Sapphire did make a primary investment into the company. It made into the company, and Sapphire is exiting at double the value in the OFS as well. So how do you explain that?
First of all, nobody is exiting fully.
I'm not saying fully. I'm saying that they are exiting, right? You gave them a primary placement to raise funds of 400 odd crores in August of this year. And then the same entity is also offloading its shares in OFS at double the value.
The shares which got issued right now, they have a lock-in restrictions.
And I agree. But average wise, it is right. I mean, I understand, but every share has a distinctive number, so they're locked in. But look at the optics that you're issuing shares at half the price, and then you're allowing them to exit at double the price within 3 months.
Yeah. So there's I'll just reframe your understanding of this. So one is existing shareholders who have been there for 6 or 7 months, they have sold their shares to a set of investors who are now locked in their investment on almost a perpetual basis. Because they have, because the incoming shareholders have locked in their investment for a longer period of time, that's why they wanted a discount. The same shareholders who have currently sold at the value that you talked about have offered them part of their shareholdings in the current IPO, and even after the current IPO will retain a large portion of their shareholding. So this is really the right interpretation of what you said.
I get you know that Mr. Purohit, you know, my limited point was that, you know, you have an optics which is here where the promoters are being issued shares at half the valuation because there is a lock-in period required for 3 years or so. And the same promoters who have already existing investment are still offloading it at a higher price. It could have been the other way around, where the company which is into an expansion mode could be offering new shares to the investors and raising at this valuation, and the existing investors, you know, buying or selling along with it.
Yeah. So again, the interpretation I'll explain here. We are run by private equity investors. Private equity investors have a time horizon for their investment. The people who have sold their, the investors who have sold their shares during the private placement have therefore freed themselves from any lock-in requirement. And this lock-in is not a 3-year lock-in, but it's almost a perpetual lock-in. Now, from that perspective, therefore, for the opportunity to be able to then freely sell shares, they were willing, the selling shareholders were willing to offer their shares to promoters at a substantial discount. They are now taking some part of their shareholding to the IPO and will continue to be investors in the company even post the IPO.
How do you compare yourself with, say, Devyani International, because that's also a Yum franchisee? If I were to ask you, you know, compare yourself with that, how would you do that? Because in your IPO prospectus, you have refrained from comparing yourself with Devyani.
So first, let me tell you the Sapphire story. We are a very young company. We came into operation in 2015 and 16. When Yum brands who own KFC and Pizza Hut and Taco Bell globally, they had a lot of small franchisees who were subscale, and they required a partner to come in and consolidate this business and then take these two brands forward. So that's our history. And in a very short period of time, 5 or 6 years, we've been able to turn around this business, almost double our store base. So we would have acquired 250 stores, closed substantial number of loss-making stores. And today we have 482 stores. Both from a revenue perspective as well as profitability perspective, we are among the top three in the industry. So very strong performance in a very short duration of time. I must also tell you, one of the values that we espouse at Sapphire Foods is the value of excellence. And the value of excellence, in a very simple manner, is how do we get better every single day? And when we are compared as a young organization, we are compared to someone who's been there for 20, 25 years. You know, frankly, I'm quite flattered. And being compared to such companies just helps us to get better. And our track record over the last 4 or 5 years just shows the kind of improvements that we have been able to deliver.
So, you know, as part of your expansion strategy, you have a new agreement with Yum India. What is the kind of store count increase that you have to do every year from here on? And what is the kind of, you know, expenses or capex that would be required for that expansion plan, whether it's in India or Maldives or Sri Lanka?
So while we cannot comment on the future count, what we can tell you is how we have been growing over the last 5 years. That gives an indication. Initial 3 years, we were very cautious. The idea was to get our economic business model right on both Pizza Hut as well as KFC. We went on omnichannel strategy, tighter format, compact stores. both KFC and Pizza Hut were a reduction of 40% in terms of sizes. From a 2,700 square feet KFC stores, what we are opening now is a 1,400-1,500 square feet KFC stores. Similarly, on Pizza Hut, from a 2,400 square feet Pizza Hut stores, what we are opening is 1,200-1,300 square feet. So the tighter format omnichannel strategy meant that we can now grow more aggressive. Last year, we opened 32 stores annually, but within that, 27 stores were opening H2 of FY21. So once we were coming out of the first wave of COVID, we went further aggressive. H1 of this year, FY22, we have already opened 46 stores. Within that, 32 stores is what we've opened in quarter two of current financial year. So this gives you a pace of increased pace of expansion. This gives you some indication. In terms of future growth plans, again, twofold, organic and inorganic. On organic, to build onto the KFC and Pizza Hut side, Pizza Hut expansion in terms of store growth strategy. On inorganic side, we'll look for acquisition of scalable QSR brands. It can be in complementary categories, either in India or outside India. So these are the twofold strategy which we are going to work upon. And you spoke about the recent private placement round, where we raised for 474 crores. This gives us the capital to allow us to do that as we move forward.
No, I get that. My limited point was that your amendment is with the YUM is coming into force from 1st January 2022. And that requires you to set up a certain number of new stores every year. So if you can elaborate on that, what kind of new store is, I know in the past how you've been there, but last 2 years have been very square and chunky because of the COVID issue. So is there a particular timeline for the stores to come in? What is kind of what does your agreement with YUM India entail? That's what I wanted to understand.
So our agreement with YUM actually requires us to open X number of stores every year. The agreement.
What is that X? That's what I wanted to know.
Because we are required to follow the IPO guidelines, we will not be able to comment on the future number right now. That's the only constraint. The development agreement is extended till 2026 for both KFC as well as Pizza Hut brand. And in return for Kavu's commitment to open X number of stores, what Sapphire gets is basically some form of waivers. The waivers can be from either initial fee, store fee waiver, or in form of marketing or royalty waiver, or a combination of this. So that's but very difficult to comment right now on exact number of stores to be opened in future.
Okay. I know you will not elaborate more than that, but I was trying. Sanjay, give me a perspective of how the entire business model has changed post-COVID. You were initially putting up large format stores. Now, everyone is moving towards smaller formats. And if you look at aggregator businesses coming for you, it's gone up significantly. You know, in last year, I think 40% was coming, around 40% or odd was coming through aggregators or something. So my question is that, what is this change that is happening and how are you adapting to that business model change which is there?
So at Sapphire Foods, right from inception, we believed that store sizes had to progressively be reduced. So when we took over the business, on an average, KFC stores were 2,700 square foot stores, Pizza Hut were 2,400, 2,500 stores. And perhaps from a channel perspective, more focused on dine-in. But over the last 3-4 years, we have singularly been focusing on an omni-channel experience and therefore improve our accessibility to consumers through all channels, dine-in, takeaway, own delivery, as well as aggregator delivery. During the COVID pandemic, during the initial period when dine-in was completely closed, we pivoted very strongly to home meal replacement, which is both takeaway as well as delivery. And we've seen a dramatic growth in our delivery sales as well as our takeaway sales, to the extent that in FY19, delivery contributed 21%. Today, FY19 delivery was 21% of our business. In FY21, it is 42% of our business. So there is a strong pivot towards delivery. Having said that, dine-in continues to remain strong, and we have seen towards the second half of last year and today, as restrictions open up, dine-in continues to bounce back. And therefore, going forward, we believe dine-in, takeaway, and delivery, all three channels are important to be able to improve accessibility to consumers.
Mm-hmm. So, are you looking at smaller format of stores or cloud kitchen formats which can do a lot of delivery based approach? Is that will be the new model change which is there? Of course, dining will be there, but if you want to expand rapidly and capture a geographical area, is that going to be the approach for you guys?
Let me explain this quite simply. So if you look at our store, a significant portion of the capital that we put in the store is really in the kitchen, because the equipment, etc., is all very differentiated. Most of that is imported. And therefore, the cost of the front of house is significantly lesser than the cost of the back of house or kitchen. And hence, when you look at a store, when a large portion of the capex is in any case in the kitchen, then it is advantageous to be able to do dine-in, takeaway, as well as delivery. And therefore, you talked about cloud kitchens, which are delivery only. We don't believe in the format. We believe that you have to be able to do dine-in, takeaway, and delivery. That is a time when you are able to optimize the size of a store. And look at our history. From 2,700 square feet KFC stores, today a 1,500 square foot KFC store delivers the same kind of revenue as a large footprint store. Same thing in Pizza Hut. 1,200 square foot store delivers the same kind of revenue that a 2,400 square foot Pizza Hut store delivers. I'll give you a great example. In Powai, we had a 4,000 square foot store that did X amount of sale. This was one of the first stores that we closed down in 2015. Today, we've got a store, 1,377, which is one third the size, which does exactly the same kind of revenue as the large store. Because the large store was only dependent on dine-in, today this smaller format store delivers great dine-in experience, but takeaway and delivery also have come in, and therefore we are able to run this store on much lower operating costs, but at the same kind of revenue. So this is the future, really, of the business.
So you're trying to get the mix right with in terms of the area which you're trying to bring in, which brings in much more ROI for your investment in that sense. Get that. My other question was with respect to the fact that I was seeing an interesting observation in your RHP with respect to the new stores, average revenue coming from the new stores, which are much higher than the overall average revenue of the stores. Is it because you have recalibrated the stores and that's or new areas you have gone to, because of that you're seeing a higher revenue coming from the newer stores?
So each store would actually behave very differently. Yes, in some years you would have seen that new stores delivering higher ADS. In some years you would also see new stores delivering a lower ADS compared to overall brand ADS. At times when you enter a new trade area, new market especially, the initial euphoria of the customers enables us to deliver really high ADS, which settles down. So there are both kind of examples where you initially see higher ADS and at times you see even lower ADS. Compared to the overall brand ADS.
And just okay. For viewers, I must explain, ADS means average daily
sales. Yes.
Others, it's an acronym that we use frequently within the industry, but viewers must be wondering, what are we talking about?
That's right. That's right. That's good that you're explaining it to them, because they will be closely watching you once you list on the stock exchange. Also, I wanted to get some more idea on the smaller format stores. Are you also looking at opening these stores beyond the cities to in in malls or airports and others? Is that something which is there within your expansion plan?
So the idea is, how do we improve accessibility of both KFC as well as Pizza Hut? And I'll give you two examples. There are many parts of Mumbai city where both KFC and Pizza Hut perhaps are not available, simply because we don't have a store, we don't have a store in a particular locality. So the opportunity to expand our presence in in just Mumbai city is perhaps three or four fold over the next 3 or 4 years. So our expansion strategy is both to increase our penetration in the largest cities and then in a selective manner to be able to go to new cities and plant a flag of either KFC or Pizza Hut there.
Okay, so is tier 2 and tier 3 city a big focus for you guys? How do you decide on the cities and where do you want to expand? What are the factors which you look at?
So I'll give you again a nice example. So there are many cities where, say, 3 or 4 years ago, we would have had just one store. So I'll take the example of Madurai. Madurai is, close to a 2 million population store. 3 or 4 years ago, we just had one store. Once the store crosses a certain amount of sales revenue, we know that it has potential for us to be able to open a second store. The second store then stabilizes and hits those internal benchmarks. Once it hits those internal benchmarks, we know a third store can be opened and a fourth and so on. The same thing we are seeing in a large city. So I'll give you one recent example. For example, we had one of our largest or highest grossing stores of KFC in Mumbai is on Linking Road. It's one of our flagship stores. 15 days ago, we opened another store, which is about a kilometer and a half away from that store. Very little cannibalization of the existing store. This store, which is just a short distance away from the old store, still is doing exceedingly well. So really, this is the way. Once the brand hits a certain amount of sales revenue thresholds, we come to know then that it is ripe for further expansion.
So is it what you look at, an EBITDA number, or is it a sales number or margins? Or what is that that makes leads you to make the next expansion plan?
So it's a combination of firstly the sales revenue number, the average daily sales, which is a proxy for the total sales. And then higher the average daily sales in most restaurant businesses give you economies of scale and therefore margins. So it's a combination of both sales as well as profitability.
Okay. So is there a plan that you have that in the next 3 to 5 years, X percentage of your stores will be in tier 2 and tier 3 city? And secondly, you do compete, there's a non-exclusive agreement with Yum India. So, and there are two partners in India for them, Devyani and you. Is there an agreement between you two on the areas where you can go and enter, or is it it's a free for all, means you can enter any area and look at an expansion there?
So difficult to give again the guidance in terms of the mix, how it will pan out, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3. Currently our RHP mentions that we are present across 30 odd cities, 30 to 50 odd cities between KFC and Pizza put together. So that's where our expansion probably would focus on, but very difficult to give exact mix beyond that. In terms of our store opening rights, territorial rights, we have right to operate in 10 states for KFC in India and operate in 11 states for Pizza Hut in India. And these 10 and 11 states are significant contributions in terms of GDP to India. They contribute roughly 56% GDP to India. So these are the states where we would expand as we move forward.
And is there overlap between you and Devyani in some of these states?
So there is no overlap between us and the other sister franchisee. In case of a KFC format, we operate in our own territories. Similarly, on a Pizza Hut, the omnichannel format with Sapphire operates, again, there is no overlap between us and the other sister franchisee. On Pizza Hut delivery format, yes, the other sister franchisee has rights to open even in the same territory states as Sapphire does, but not in the same trade area. What we mean by trade area is that where Sapphire has a store already present, a particular radius in terms of a drive time, the other franchisee cannot block another store, so that we don't cannibalize or address the same store.
So is that what is it? 5 kilometers or 7 kilometer radius? What is it?
It is more driven by drive time, because at the end of the day, when you deliver pizza, it's all about delivering that pizza in the shortest possible time. So it's driven by drive time. So the kilometer would be different for each store. It's map basis, the peak hour drive time, which is required by a rider to deliver the pizza.
Vijay, give me a sense of how your margins are looking, because you know, there has been some changes to the way formats your work because of the lease rentals which have been reduced for you in the 1 or 2 years. How are you looking at your margin expansion? Will you be able to sustain this kind of margins which is there?
So again, I would refrain from giving a forward-looking statement.
Let me put it this way. What are the headwinds or tailwinds you see to your margins?
Yes. So if you see the journey over the last 3 to 4 years for Sapphire, we have been continuously chipping away at the, on the cost and delivering cost efficiencies. Our margins improved by 50 basis points last year, FY21, and we delivered an EBITDA of 18.9% pre-ESOP level. So the journey has been there for last 3 years for to see already in top three in terms of the profitability in such a short period of time. So we continue to work upon the programs which delivers cost efficiencies, but how this would move forward, I would refrain from commenting on that.
Yeah.
And but, what about
But I think it's important to talk about the measures that we have taken to improve profitability. So
yes,
from a gross margin perspective, through both intelligent pricing, menu mix changes, as well as some pricing, gross margins have improved. During the COVID period, it allowed us a once in a lifetime opportunity to actually indulge in zero-based budgeting, and therefore our cost of labor improved, our operating costs improved. We were able to reduce rentals and in line with our sales. And yes, we got some waivers on rentals, but it was offset a little bit by increased delivery costs. As we go forward, we believe that the improvements that we have made are quite sustainable, and we should be able to hold on to these efficiencies. And perhaps as our scale improves, improve on this too.
So, Sanjay, you're not profitable as of now for the last 3 years. The investors would like to get some idea for your profitability part or glide path towards profitability. What do you have to say on that part?
From an EBITDA margin perspective, there has been a complete transformation in this business. 5 or 6 years ago, when we acquired these businesses, they did not make any money at the corporate EBITDA level. Today, our corporate EBITDA is among the top three in the industry. As we add stores and we improve our scale, I'm quite sure that in a period of time, we will be PAT positive also.
Okay. So FY22 or 23 will be a year for that?
We would refrain from commenting on that.
Yeah, so I can't comment on forward-looking. You know that very well.
So my final question to you is, you know, we have seen opening up happening across the country. What kind of sales and footfalls have you seen in Q2? I don't want any numbers as such, but from a qualitative perspective, if you can give us an idea of, do you see delivery still continue high and footfalls low, or you're seeing delivery footfalls now coming in gradually to the stores?
So I'll give you a 18-month perspective. So the first half of last year, when restrictions were quite severe, our business was impacted. But as restrictions eased, consumers started to come back to our stores. Delivery continued to increase. So quarter three was better than first half. Quarter four was better than quarter three. In quarter one, yes, we were impacted because, again, April and May were there were a significant restriction. But as we see restrictions lift, malls coming back, cinema complexes starting to open, we are seeing a resurgence in dine-in. Our delivery continues to hold, but now dine-in is starting to come back very strongly.
Okay. Sanjay Purohit and Vijay Jain, thank you very much for joining us on IPO Adda. The Sapphire Foods IPO opens on November 9th, closes on 11th. Offer for sale of 2,073 crores, giving a company the market cap of 7,089 crores at the upper end of the price band. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us on Bloomberg Quint.
Thank you very much. And to all viewers of Bloomberg Quint, very happy Diwali. Stay safe, stay healthy, and may Diwali be very prosperous for all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Pleasure talking to you. Thanks for having us.
Thank you.